professor Nicolas Guerra, que está visitando nosso programa de pós essa semana, dia 16, para estar trabalhando no livro junto. E aproveitando para fazer duas falas dele aqui no programa. A primeira ontem, vocês estavam todos aqui, da educação basicamente sustentável, e hoje é o outro lado da carreira de Nicolas, que é sobre ensino de genética. So I just said that you have two sides, ESD and genetics education, but now it's genetics education.
Yeah, so today it's nice to see you here again, and I mean that's why I'm really here in Salvador, is because we are working together in Charlotte before, and we are having a mission to write a book, and much of that is built on our previous work, and today I will just talk about that, and it's kind of which I did for some years ago, the work today, which was part of my thesis, more or less, and also some of we worked on afterwards as well, but most of it is a little bit work we did in the last years. So this was my title of my thesis, Science versus School Science, because what's it about? It's in genetics, but it's what's in science and how it is transferred or transposed into the classroom and what happens in this process. That's the main target, main aim in this overall project. So that's why I choose to call it Science versus School Science. And much of that is what we are sitting now and writing about in genetics. And the framework to use within that, when I wrote my thesis, was I looked into multiple models. And I will come into more about what that is, that you can represent a phenomena with models. And here is about genetics, gene function, and how this comes out in textbooks and how it is related to students' understanding. So, so this is a part of, this is the overall aim, and there are sub-projects in it. Hello. And in my writing of my thesis, I used a framework called didactic transposition. It's from a Frenchman, Chevalier, Yves Chevalier, a mathematical educational researcher that has developed that framework. And it's about this, the transposition, how knowledge comes from the academy and how it is transposed into the classroom. And then you have different processes ongoing here. So in this overall project, you could say that I looked into these processes and was interested in the outcomes of this on the learned knowledge in students in school. It's the same as I said yesterday. If you have any questions, just interrupt them and you can feel free to ask questions. So, we have the science, we have students, and what I'm talking about, this comprises of a couple of different studies. So, when I did my thesis, I did one paper, which was focusing here and related to here. That's one sub-study I will talk about. And then the main thing, which we did a lot, and then in Chartwell we did a paper as well about that, is about the textbooks, how that comes into the textbooks, also through curricula. And this is the, you could say, one step of the didactic transposition. And then there is the students, of course, they read the textbooks, hopefully, and learn from the textbooks. So I also did a study in which I had students interpret the content knowledge of their textbooks and in interviews. So here you have, you can say, three different main studies, but it was two papers about the textbooks. One about this comparison and about this. Then, of course, you could take in the well. The teachers are also influenced from the textbooks from here and also have an influence here. I will not talk about this. I didn't have time or resources to do about this in my thesis. But afterwards, I have supervised a PhD student working because I just would be into teachers and their way of teaching in the school. But I will not include that in this talk because it would be too much. But this is a kind of a nice framework to use when you do research and do a thesis to make it kind of something that you can relate to. So, why I'm up so this was a little bit nice to talk about this because I'm right now before this event here, I'm sitting and writing in this chapter, this book we are doing about these issues. So I have to remind myself because I've not been into this for so much the last years. Well, it's very known that it's been empirical studies since long, already since the 1980s, that genetics within biology is very difficult to learn for students. So in that sense, it's difficult for a teacher to teach because the teachers don't learn what we want them to learn. And there, here's just one, but here is a kind of review. This researcher did about explanations for why this might be difficult. But when doing this research, my idea was that, well, there could be another reason. And if you look at the reasons by Nick Nichols and others, it's more about ontological obstacles, micro, micro, and so on. But as I said, my was a little bit in the epistemology, how you understand the knowledge, how the knowledge is used in the classroom, and the relation between the conceptual knowledge and the understanding about what knowledge is. So the idea here is that this is a little bit of a hypothesis that I used in my work. So could it be that here the students have difficulties in understanding the genetics? Most research has been conducted here. There's something happening here in the teaching, in the classroom that leads to this. And a lot of the literature is about that students might have everyday conceptions. But I started here in the academic and the scholarly knowledge. What about the history and philosophy of biology? Can that, the development and the structure of the genetic knowledge, and what's happening with that in this process, can that be a reason for why this is difficult to learn? That was my working hypothesis in which I worked with in this project. Yeah. So I more or less said what is on this picture here. So. Can the learning problems be due to the dialectic transposition? The structuring here, what's happening with the scientific knowledge in tenure schools? So, first we need to talk about what is science and what is school science. And it's not the same, with different objectives. And this is very old, but very much used. Kind of categorization of what are we teaching in school science. Well, when we talk about science, we are talking mostly about this, the theories, the concepts, the models. We say teaching science or teaching in science, and the content knowledge, that's what we often are supposed to learn. And if you look in the curricula, it's lots about it. And this is what the scientists do. I mean, when they write a research paper in genetics and publish it, of course they have done research that we know more about the genes or the genome or how to develop techniques to make new biotechnological advancements. So what they then do, they are here, and to some extent also here, we because they need to do a scientific inquiry to end up with new knowledge. But this is what the scientists do. But in school science, when a teacher teaches, this might also be a bit different in different countries. Perhaps in Colombia, we have different ways. So what you teach in school might be different in different countries because you have different curricula. In some countries you are very focused here, but if you go to a European context or a North American context, you can find almost all these three aspects, and I will guess also in Brazil and Colombia in the curricula. So it's not only this, because you should also know how to advance this. You have a lot of lab work, inquiries and stuff in the school. And that is a goal in itself to learn about inquiry. And then you have goals to learn about knowledge. So you, what counts as an explanation of science? What's the difference between, for example, a non-scientific idea, like a creationist idea, compared to a scientific evolutionary theory and so on? So these aspects are also important. And in my research here, I am looking especially about these two relations, and when this comes into to school science, how does these two reinforce and help each other, or do they? I have not looked into this so much. So, when I then looked, what is science? You can use different ways. You can talk about concepts, theories, laws, and so on. I have talked about models, because they're scientific models. Model is a way of describing science. And I think I got a question yesterday from someone that said, which framework and why? Well, it's the same here. You have to choose one framework in when you do research. So, and models and modeling is a very important aspect of science education. So, skip that. And models are representations. We have, I mean, science is always about the real world. We need to, we like to get explanations of phenomena in the real world, as we can experience in the natural world. And when we're talking in biology, then we're talking about the living world of organisms, processes, how they live and so on. So we have something here that we can think of as an objective reality, something that we can see and observe. But when we make ourselves an understanding and an explanation of that, we can never account for the whole phenomenon as such, because we don't have enough, what you could say, power to describe every aspect of it. So we would use and choose some aspects of the phenomena to describe. And when we do that, we describe, then it becomes a representation or a model of the phenomena we are describing. So, and this is what we teach about, both in the sciences and in school science. It's not here, although it's down here. And then what's happening in science, it's evolved over the years. So the scientists, when they discover new things, they develop new models. So, and this is what I call multiple models. And since I was interested in genetics, what the phenomena to be studied here is, what I was interested in, is the gene. And it's the basic unit for heredity, which a specific function can design. And this is something that is very, that we think is very static. We can observe that, but the way they explain that can vary. This is kind of also a model of the involvement of scientific knowledge. As you read about Lakatos and his research programs, and this is another way of explaining it. The same thing, you could say that you have something that is kind of constant in the in our understanding of the scientific phenomena out in nature. He talked about the inner or core, and this doesn't change. So here is the phenomena. But as science progress and the new knowledge are accumulated, new ideas are tested, and then you have this, the outer belt here, or the soft core, in which you have models or theories that are not so firmly decided. These are more tentative knowledge. When science progress, ideas here might enter here because they might be established as facts more or less. So if we have the Darwin's evolutionary theory, it has been held now for well, almost 200 years, 150 at least. And then we would say that it's not likely that someone will come up with a falsification of that theory. It is not really likely. So we will put that here because that is kind of firm. We know that there is something called DNA that is regulating the derivative. Well, that is kind of also something that we are quite sure of. It will also be put here. This will not change. However, here, what's more that could be explained, we could have more not so certain knowledge. So we can have, for example, if we take about genetics, we have what we call the junk DNA. We don't know so much. There are ideas about what that's used for. So it might be here, and we can see what if it will enter here or not here. So these are different ways of describing. So I would say the models are up here. Some models disappear because they are falsified, and some ones may enter here. So when I did my classification, you have some kind of core, the phenomena we talked about, and then you have something here that is changing. And these are kind of, you have structure, organization level. Are we talking about the phenomena? Are we talking about cells or molecules? Different processes, biochemical processes, and the different entities that are part here, the molecules or particles or whatever. So these are ways that you could categorize different descriptions, and this is what you can look in the secondary or the outer soft core. This has varied in the description in genetics. So I use that as a framework to categorize. So, now we are out here, and I start my investigation to look into the history and philosophy of genetics. How does it look like when you look at this historical development of genetics? But then, why is this important? Well, then I go back to school science. This is from a paper from a book from Gilbert. And they talk about models, and this is a kind of progression. What is models in education? And you see I've done a line here, and this should symbolize that here we are more or less in science, and here we are out of science, and more in the school science. According to their framework, they talk about how models evolve in science. The researcher come up with an idea, he described it in a paper, they test it in scientific inquiries, more researchers do it, and then they agree upon that this is a good way of describing, so then it becomes what we call a consensus model. And if a large amount of scientists do this, agree upon that this is a good description, then we have a scientific model. This can live for a long or short time in the science community until a new idea emerges. And we have a new model that kind of outcompetes the old one. That then this scientific model might be outdated. It might lead to the power imbalance and go, you could say, to the graveyard. Or it could stay and they can live in parallel. It differs. But then it can become a historical model because the scientists don't use it so much anymore. But that doesn't mean that it loses all of its importance. Because in school, we never are at the frontier of research. The kids in school are not researchers. They have to start to learn something based on their everyday knowledge. So, what we do in school often that we start with, because the historical ones are often the more simple ones. So we often in school we teach about historical scientific facts, not the contemporary one. So that's why the history of science has a very big importance in school. If you go in mathematics, often the knowledge taught in school are several hundred years old. But that is more in the inner belt, but it's not that good. If you go to physics, it's also 100 or often or 150 years if you are in high school. Chemistry the same. Biology is a little bit more modern, perhaps 50 to 100 years old, but it's but we often start in this history of science. And this is transferred into curriculum models and teaching models used by teachers. So that's why we have differences between school science and the real science. So that's why the history and philosophy of science is very important. So if you look at this, what should we teach about? This is a very interesting, very difficult question. It's not easy to select because there's so much out there. So what to put in the classroom? So I went into my first study and looked into the history and philosophy of genetics and looked at different models. How can this be described? Well, these are four different ways of describing this. You recognize it, I guess? Yeah. This is, of course, a kind of abstract representation, like in Mendel genetics. This is like the classical genetics. You have these different genes are represented here. Here you can represent a gene like this. Or it can be different segments like this. It's also, so this is more or less the same thing, but it's different models, but it's representing the same phenomenon. And this is, of course, you can see the historical axis here. So the first one, of course, was Mendel. And now we're back in the 1860s. He was, of course, rediscovered in the 90s, beginning of the 1900s. Hunt Morgan, he was leading this fly experiment laboratory that developed the chromosome theory and the beads on the string. They looked at the gene as particulate, as following them, they made maps, like different segments on the chromosome, because they couldn't reach the molecular level at that time. Peter and Tortum here, they looked at the old biochemistry way. And of course we have the, when we come into the molecular way. So of course we have an historical axis here. So has this an impact in school? Contemporary researchers, I mean, they are not talking about ideas like these guys come up with for 100 years ago or 60 years ago or 50 years ago. I will not go through with this. You can read the papers afterwards, but in my work then, I did a classification within concept mapping to describe these different models. And so here we did these five different models, the Mendelian way, the classical, the Hunt-Morgan, the biochemical, that we have there. One protein is called is produced by a gene. Here we become a genetic molecular model that we have one part of the DNA chromosome goes in. And in the dilution of the gene concept in the last 30 years, now we know that a gene can consist of different segments of the DNA strand together, which make up parts of components that you get in this form, polypeptides. So the idea here is that we have something that is static, the idea. We have different descriptions of this idea, and we can look at the difference between the models. Then we have a variation of descriptions, and that is what we call the conceptual variation. And in that work, we find different areas where you have a conceptual variation. How the relation between structure and function is described, that varies between the relation between which organizational level. In the Mendelian, you are just on the phenomena. If you talk about the classical gene, Hunter Morgan, then you are at the cell level. But if you go to the molecular, you are at the molecular level. And also the reach, so you are different biological levels. You can go either way. From a Mendelian perspective, you start on the phenotype and extrapolate to some abstract unit which you call the gene. In a more modern way, you start with the molecule and extrapolate to the, how you define it. You have different types of relationships in the model. They can be causal or more idealistic and more naturalistic, that there is as biochemical processes. So it's not the same kind of relations in the different models, in different kinds. And then you have a problem of reduction between these different organizational levels. When you go from one level to another and you say that there is a relation between them, it's not that easy to make that relation. And also the different models, in which way do they account for the environmental factors also are responsible for the outcomes of genes. So, yeah. So we will take one here example, the first one. So this is just one way. So here is one, and then you can find it. And this is the way we looked into the main kind of an instrument to describe this conceptual variation. Yeah, so what would I like to say here? Yeah, so here is the example I use all the time here. You have the Mendelian gene, the particle gene, segment gene of DNA for several parts. Now, we were here, so we can see here that in here, we have different ways of describing it. Now, we will go here. Okay, in the first study, what we did was looking into the, because there are lots of literature about students' understanding of genetics. What does that literature say? So here is a lot of lists. I will not go through that. But you can say that the most frequently reported view seems to be that genes are considered to be particles or determining characteristics. Making a link between genes and protein synthesis is rare. So here this will talk about that students, when you interview them, talk with them, they talk like this: genes are particles, determine characteristics. They have inherent actions that can make something happen. It makes an action. It's not like, yeah. They are transmission of these between. Here is a little bit different. Productive sequence, okay, is more related to the DNA. So what would you make of all this? If you look what all these people here, this researchers community has claimed. If you look at these papers, they say the students have conceptions that are in line with everyday conceptions. What is that? So, there is everyday conceptions. Well, my claim here is that no, it's not. It's not everyday conceptions. It's those two. So that what we see that the students in school, in high school, but also in university talk about it as a kind of a command, or is a particle, is something that determines something. And it's exactly the way we describe genes in Mendelian genetics and classical genetics. So, I didn't quite agree there with the literature how they describe the problem. So, the hypothesis to start looking into to this textbook research that in the next step was that what are we really teaching the kids? What kind of genetics are entering school? Why did I put this in once again? Well, we can skip that. So, what is to be taught in the transposition? So then we did a lot of we can look at the curricula. It's much help. Swedish curricula is very short, so it more or less gives some guidelines of what topics to teach. One or two pages each subject, and then it's up to the teacher to fulfill that. But nevertheless, it's very essential that if you use biological theories and models, that's very clear. So what is then really taught here? So we go into in the textbooks. Here are some of them. And then you can, first of all, why choosing textbooks? Well, of course, it's very easy to analyze. Charles will also do that because it's easy accessible. So that's one way. But it's also more than that because textbooks are very influential in what's happening in the classroom because the students read them and the teachers use them when they plan their lessons and when they structure the lessons. So there's lots of research about that. So what is really taking place in the classroom is guided a lot of textbooks. So what stands there has the importance of what the students encounter. Yeah. So, here is some quotes from textbooks. This one here. One tries to cross-breeding to unite valuable traits. So here they talk about traits in a phenomenological level. So this is, hope you catch it. This is more like Mendelian genetics. A gene is a matter of fact, it's very normative here. A tiny part, a segment of DNA with a large amount of triplets which codes for a specific protein. Well, this is very much so wasn't a quick model. So here they say this, and here it says that. And this is the same book. Here's another quote. Those parts of a gene that code for a protein are called exons, blah, blah, blah. During the transcription first and then mRNA and so on here. This is from one book and this is a very rare explanation. So this is a more advanced model, you could say the modern model. This is what you could say the new classical model when it becomes DNA, and this is Mendelian model. All of this exists in the textbook. So, this conceptual variation can be found. And this is from the tables which we made. This is from a paper with Charbel also. So here you can see the different models. And here we have analyzed all the Swedish textbooks. not so many really, but it's kind of, I think it's 5 or 6 in biology. It's a small country, not like Brazil, only 9 million inhabitants. So here you can see the distribution, the frequency, how often do you encounter a specific model? Well, the one that is 150 years old, you encounter like this almost 20-25%. This was this, we could say that 100 years old is also quite common. This one that is, now it is 6 years old. And this that is 7 years old. And the modern model here, what is more like the science of today, in the textbooks, is very rare. So, what would you expect the students to learn from this? Well, I would expect them to learn what is the most frequent, abundant in the textbooks. And of course, it verifies the previous research. Students have these conceptions. Well, they have learned their homework. Great. Here we did the same with English. I used books from Canada, US, England, Australia. More or less the same. The English books are much thicker, especially the American and Canadian, very thick books. But and there are more pages. But the distribution is almost the same. This I haven't done. This is from the Brazilian. Charles Dan, you can see it's more or less the same. It's even less of the modern model. And even more, I think, a little bit of the classical genetics. But it's the same kind of discourse in all countries, same version of genetics. And here is also, I just took pictures from the books, you know. This is kind of a DNA, RNA. So here is a trait in English. I think this is a great because it's so very, it goes in one direction, it's the classical Crick idea that the information goes in one direction and it's very kind of deterministic. Here you have almost the same, like this. This is the neoclassical model you could say. So what we can say from this is that these ideas of portraying genetics is very much like a deterministic way of portraying it. So, to summarize the results of the textbook analysis, all models are present in parallel, they're used in between. The contemporary model, the modern genetics, the research frontier is very seldom. So you can't expect the students to learn so much from that. All the reductionist or determinist model dominates, which are very causal, mechanistic explanations. But also there's a mix of these models. We talked about often the kind of classical model and then link it to the proteins and so on. So there is a very hybrid model, we call it. Often in different disciplines, you are using sub-disciplines. If you're talking about evolution, you almost always use a kind of Mendelian model in the chapters of the textbook. And the textbook of high school, I don't know if I said that, in Sweden it's about 60, 90 years old. So you are taking biology and then are coming to the university. This is what they are learned before they enter the university. However, very important also, they never talk about there is any models, they just use them. They just say that this is the way, that, as I showed you the quote, this is a fact. And then 3 pages, but this is also a fact. But the facts is the models. So they are talking like this is the way it is. They don't talk about it, that this is a description of how we describe the reality. So it's very much like normative way of talking about. And they never talk about any controversies between the models, or that you can view reality in different ways. So, we are on track now. We have seen first that okay was here, and the older models is very much what researchers found students to think about. We have looked into the textbooks and found that what they talk about is these old models, and they mix them, and they don't give an explanation for it. So, the hypothesis is strengthened that this transposition of scientific knowledge into school might cause problems, because the students are taught the old models, the hybrid models, and they don't talk about the right models. Can students really make sense of it? For you and me, it's no problem. We are the experts, we have learned a lot of biology. But in school, we have the novices. They don't have the skills to do. So how do they interpret this? So that was the last study I did, to try to find out in which way can students decipher, understand this implicit message in the textbook. Can they understand that? Make meaning of it. Okay. Yeah, I don't think I put in so much here in slides, but I can just describe. I did an experimental study in Sweden, like in many countries. The textbooks often have two chapters at least, two more fundamental chapters, one with more classical Mendelian genetics and one with more. And that has the historical reasons, of course. So what I did, I went into the students 18 years old, so and they had this genetic course. So they were having a homework to read this chapter, and I let the other half of the class read the another chapter. So some read the molecular and some the classical. And then they were giving a questionnaire built on this framework and had to describe, based on how they tick the boxes, what, how you make meaning of, how is the gene and genetics described in textbooks. And they ticked in this questionnaire. And then I swapped, so they were changed. So those that have read the classical one, read the molecular one. And then I did the same thing again. And afterwards, I interviewed 10 of them or something like that to see, to interview to, what did they interpret of their textbooks. So unfortunately here, I think, because there are so many slides, I thought I didn't put in the quantitative data here. But what I could see from the questionnaire was that regardless if they have written, if they have read the molecular or the classical chapter, they tended to answer to tick in the alternatives which describe the classical way of describing genes and gene function. So that was a little bit odd, because when they did this assignment, they had their book, they could look in the book, they read, they have had it at homework, but still they tended towards the classical one. And then I did interviews to see how did they do this. So here are some quotes from the interviews afterwards. So I asked them, do these chapters describe the same thing? Why do you think there are two chapters in genetics? Why not one? Why? So the most common answer was yes, the text have different depth. Well, one is an explanatory model that builds on the other. I think the first, it might correspond more to this, I showed pictures. And then it will go that you go more in depth. In depth means that you go molecular. So for them, there was no qualitative difference. It was more a difference of detail. For them, they couldn't understand it were different frameworks. So that explains a little bit why they tick the same boxes. Why was the author divided into two chapters? What you just meant here? Well, they invented more or less explanations because they didn't know that there was something called classical or molecular genetics. So, if you understand more fully, I think they could as well as present as one. There is no reason for it. Here is one interesting. Perhaps it has to do with the fact that they deal with different things. The first is about how genes function, and the second, how the genes affect our appearance. So function is here the molecular way, and how the appearance is the classical way. There are actually quite different things. So here, they have a kind of an understanding that there are two different frameworks, but still, but they don't see the connection between them. So they cannot relate that. And in this paper I wrote, I was very interested in it, and I was very much into models and modeling. So I wrote, if you see, which I talked about, in one page you have one description of genes, and three page later you have a difference. Could they see that themselves? So I asked about this, and I showed them the books and said, here it says that the gene is this, here it says that that. Why is that? What sense can you make of that? Here are some excerpts from those interviews. I like this very much. In physics, I experience it because it's more inexact science.
I agree.
Biology is more precise, then you can be more sure. So, and I think perhaps this is where it's situated in the comment, but there were actually three students which I interviewed that related to this. And what it's all about, I think, was that because the physics teacher, he talked about that we are using models. And he said, well, we cannot show you the whole reality if we do this classical thing and put the car down. Now we neglect the friction, we take that out of the system, and this is a kind of a way of just describing it. They talk in those terms. In biology, the biology teacher never talks about it in that terms. They talk about this is how the way it is. This is the organ of this organism. This looks like this, and you take a painter. So it's more like a realist way of describing it. So biology teachers are tending not to view it like the models, more like the phenomena. And here is just one quote that describes that when they meet the contradiction, he doesn't talk about genetics here, but well, in physics with the conservation of energy, and then later maybe stated that energy is created, it seemed to me so obviously a rumor, you get disturbed about it. So here, this was the best student, he could see that there were contradictions in the book, but he could not make sense of it. He just think that the textbook author is crazy and hasn't done his homework. But I mean, he didn't understand that you can talk about it in different ways. So although he could discover it, the only one that did that, he could not make sense of it. So what of this study, what can you make some conclusions? Well, they have very difficult detecting the use of these multiple models and the conceptual variation because they ticked in the same in the questionnaires. They don't recognize the existence of qualitative difference between the models, and they're usually aware of that there is models. When you ask them, is there models inside? Yes, of course there are models, but they see them more like these different levels of detail, not like it is different ways of viewing and different perspectives, it's just details. So for them, if you can match one model on the other, and you can make what I talked about, this explanatory reduction, you can reduce from one model to another. But in this way, if you have a particular gene, or a Mendelian gene, or a DNA gene, you cannot extrapolate to another, because there are different ways of describing it. Yeah. So, some conclusions. This feature that describes the concept of variation, which I showed you before, the students have difficulty to see that variation. They cannot they cannot identify it. And where you have a variation, the literature talks about misconceptions. So, where you have a variation, you can anticipate that the students will have problems learning it. So the students also they acquire the wrong model because we are teaching them this simplified Mendelian classical genetics. So more or less the issue is perhaps not that they learn the wrong thing, they are learning the thing, but are we teaching the right thing? So it's much about what we teach, not so much perhaps about what the students learn or work. So, if I go back to this, we have the knowledge in genetics, doing genetics, inquiry about genetics. So, this is a little bit of the conclusions of my work. And here is the models. You can find them in the textbooks. The teachers do inquiry about this. Was totally missing in the textbooks. So this is kind of a missing link. And my assumption here was that if you take that away, you reduce also the understanding of the content because you don't get the tools to understand it at different points. So you have the phenomena and the models and what's happening in school. In the textbooks and teachers teaching, well, they kind of merge. It becomes the same thing in biology. Not in physics, I would say so much, but in biology. So everything becomes the phenomena. So it becomes a story of how things are. The problem is there are different stories in the same time. So a lack of epistemological understanding, the nature of science, probably also lead that you have problems to understand this concept of variation in the content knowledge. Yeah. I skipped that one. So here is the papers, if you are more interested, because now I talk very fast and give some picture here, picture there. So if you are interested and want to learn more, it's better to read the papers, and then you can send me an email if you want more explanation. there was the last one here with the colleagues here in Salvador. So, yeah, thank you.
Questions?
You're working in genetics.
Yeah. Yeah. In my work, in the interview with students of the graduation in Europe, many students talking about being a career or information, like information of one characteristic.
You take it in Portuguese so someone can explain, translate.
Meio que bloqueado.
Mas em português a gente traduz.
Tá, muitos estudantes eles falam de genes como que ele carrega informações. Só isso. E que é tipo aquele mito, né? Aquele mito de que o gene só carrega informação e deixa por fora outras coisas, né? Outras coisas que tipo, aqueles modelos que você falou sobre modelo molecular, modelo clássico, também, grande majoritariamente, os estudantes falam desse modelo, mas a minha preocupação é que também se fala de que o gene só carrega informações e deixam por fora outras coisas. Não só isso, porque a biologia não tem informação, não tem uma teoria sobre informação.
Oh, yeah, yeah, he's worried about that when he, when he interviews the grad students. They only talk about information, so genes carry information. And they put aside all the molecular details and all those models that you talked about. The students only focus on information, and there isn't a good definition, information theory for biology. So that's something that
the only mention of the genes are genetic message and information.
Which level is that? Which kind of students?
Yeah, what kind of students? Isso
não são dos
graduação?
Graduação,
a maioria.
Undergrad.
Yeah, I mean, it's... well, of course, that might be a problem. And it depends, of course, also who they are, what they are undergraduate. Are they biologists? Then I think it's a very big problem. And I think also perhaps that one issue might be that media today, I mean, the DNA and genes are so much in the media, and there it's more like kind of this metaphorical use of it. So of course people then use the same language as they end up in the media and use it in a metaphorical way as the provider of information. So, and I think that's also some kind of, also a little bit in the same as the acting gene, that is something that transmits the information of how things should be done. And then it's done there, so it might be a little also very simplified, so you don't get a really understanding of. I think it might be a dead end in that way. But okay, if you will take it further on, so because if you use this metaphor, it's a blueprint, or it's information for a blueprint, then it's just that this is the way it should be, and it's not that it's kind of work in a process together with other factors from the cell environments and so on. So of course I agree, it might be a problem if you just have that understanding of the genes.
Even though should be a bit careful about that, because it depends on where the student is in the undergrad. The data from Leila, did a master's in this topic in the lab, shows that when they begin the genetics and some molecular biology courses before, they are very into the informational conception because they learned this in high school. The results from Vanessa shows that in Brazil there is a huge predominance of the informational conception in high school. But after the molecular biology course and after genetics, same of students afterwards, they are not accepting the informational conception anymore, and they got into the classical molecular concept. So these courses teach them that the gene is molecular, and then they don't rely more on these simple metaphors, which are used by high school textbooks because makes life a bit simpler.
But don't they include the DNA molecule in textbooks? Or because from my experience, I mean, most starts with this kind of DNA and this kind of molecule. And I think in the Swedish textbook you see very little, and also in the English very little of this information concept. It might be a Brazilian culture difference there.
I think they merge everything together. They put the DNA as the gene. DNA as a unit of information, so the gene is a message. This message written nucleotide sequence and determines phenotypes. So that's a package basically. So it's a three models in one.
So it's some kind of also kind of hybrid, and that you use different parts of different and make some that they.
It's a hybrid.
Interesting. Yeah, people see it. But of course, if it's helpful for understanding, then it might be good. So it's it you should do some research about it and see the progression.
No, no, that's what Leonardo is doing, because he's interviewing people with increasing knowledge in genetics.
Yeah.
And he's finding that, with more knowledge, we get more sophisticated take on the models. And so the classical molecular constant is more challenging the more knowledge someone has. So a geneticist doesn't work with the idea of gene as a unit in DNA and so forth. Undergrads work with this idea of informational conception. So as expected, more knowledge is being more sophisticated use of genes. There's a progression there.
But not enough.
When we have a merge of the models and phenomena, we don't come back to ontological problem, because first to me it's a problem of the very naive analytic concept of the world in the genetics.
Very naive understanding of. Could you repeat naive understanding of?
Of the genetics in biology in general. We have a very naive analytic concept. We think of, we were always talking about the helix.
Yes.
Talk about genetics is like the world is that, that's kind of thing. So we don't come back to ontological problem, no? More sophisticated epistemological problem.
Yeah. I don't know whether this might also be different in different countries, I don't know, but in the Swedish context, I think there's been a lot of kind of reduction of complexity education. You try to always go for the easiest way of explaining, and I think sometimes if you take that too far, it becomes very naive, and then you cannot make meaning of it anyway, because it becomes too simplistic. And I think that's a very delicate balance there between, of course it cannot be too complex, but if you are too simplified models and you never really challenge the students to understand or think or in a more advanced level. So I think in many parts of science, you can look at textbooks in general that they have reduced more complex models. And for example, in chemistry, if in upper secondary you never talk about chemical orbitals anymore, you just stay with the more or less the octet rule and the Bohr models and so on. So, and then you cannot progress. So, and I think it's a little bit the same in genetics. If you just stay with these simplistic models, you can never progress. So, although you cannot expect to learn the more advanced, you need to see them to challenge your mind of thinking a little bit. So, I totally agree with you that it's. I think it's problematic that you sometimes, well, that people might be, because interest for science and so on, you know, has decreased in Sweden and most Western countries, so how can we make this more accessible? People would find this more interesting, but let's make it easier, has been some kind of answer. But I think it's it can be counterproductive, because if you not become challenged, it's not interesting if it's just this simple way of thinking. I think it's a problem, and, but it's, I think it's very challenging also, because in much of the more contemporary biology and chemistry, you go so much in the biochemistry and molecular, and it soon gets very detailed and complex. So how can you include that in teaching, but not go too complex, but still make it some kind of more challenging than the older, more simplistic or causal models. That's I think is a very huge challenge to do that.
Nicholas, about the didactic transposition. You talk about the principal problems in the process to take the formal and the academic knowledge to bring to the scholar knowledge. Everyone's known of this. But I think that it's important to worry about the teacher training. You know? The teacher training is the principal topic to be worried about it, because you know, you listen to the teacher in secondary school talking about the gene, they don't worry about the kind of model that they are teaching. because they don't have knowledge about the exist a kind of models. Okay, they thought, I know the Mendelian model. I teach the if you go ahead in the B, the B model of the gene, and it's enough. And you know, it's a kind of underestimation of the student, because in secondary school you listen to teachers that they don't care about the teaching genetics deeply. You know, they are a simplistic teaching of the gene, a simplistic overview of the concept of gene. Yeah. And you know, it's so fast. I think it's a good idea to take account about the views of the teacher, the teacher's training in the secondary level, because you know oral is kind of epistemological and ontological obstacles that the students in the graduate levels have are they came from the secondary school, you know.
Yeah, I totally agree, and if you look at many of the papers, you find the same problem with the teachers as the students, and the same kind of ideas about what genetics is and so on. And of course, but one thing is that, anyway, in Sweden, I think it's the same in many countries, teacher education is, you should put in so many pieces, leading classroom, blah, 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 and so on. So it's hard to really get the time for it. But still, I think one way is to include more of what we call didactics in the courses. And I think that has been very neglected. I had no didactics when I was a teacher. I worked in upper secondary school. I didn't teach about models because I didn't have myself in my own teacher education. It was when I became a researcher. And it can also be the other way around, really, because when you talk with geneticists, many that work very highly internationally with genetics research, they are not aware of this either. For them it's no problem because they have the expert mind, so they can jump between the models. But this is a tool, I think. You can use it as a teacher to provide a step further to learn that, okay, now we introduce a new model, now we look at it in this way. And so I think in a way it can be a provider developing the teaching in the classroom, and you can talk about it. Well, you remember we talked about it in this way, and now we're talking in here way. Can you see the difference? And you can have it as an instrument for getting more advanced knowledge. But of course, then the teacher needs to know it. So, well, we are writing a book here, Charles and me, so hopefully teachers can get accessible, of course. And all of these kind of things we need to do. And of course, teacher education is the most important thing, I agree. So. Yeah, so hopefully we all can bring in that to our course as well.
And you know, all the weight of the fault is not in the teachers, you know?
Yeah.
I'm talking about all the aspects that the teaching of genetics have in, for example, in Colombia, as linked to my experience as biology teacher in Colombia, in secondary level, we have 3 weeks, or 2 or 3 weeks, to make an approach to genetics in to 13 to 15 students, you know? You don't have time to make an approach, a deeply approach in the model, one A, B, C, D model, and you know, you have to run, you know?
Yeah, I know. And you have the exams you should pass and everything, so of course it's like this. And also, it's not easy for teacher. For example, when I worked as a teacher, I had an old colleague, and when he went his teacher training, he was in chemistry. There was no biochemistry because that was more or less not invented when he had his training. And if you don't have, if not the school heads and the municipalities give in-service training to teachers, if that is not important, they will not develop their thinking. So, I mean, it's not that. Responsible only for the teachers, responsible for the principal, the school leader, and the ones that govern the schools and make sure that the teachers also get in-service training. Because you cannot get everything from your teacher training, and then you should work 40 years. You need more service training over the years to develop your teaching, I think. So.
And to close, and you have to bring biochemical and chemistry concepts that the students don't have yet.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
in the level in Colombia, for example, in the level in ninth, in eighth and ninth degree grade, that you are teaching genetics, they don't have an approach into chemistry or biochemical concepts. And when you make a deeply approach into the genetics, you need some concepts of chemistry, some concept of biochemistry that they don't have.
Yeah.
So the teacher make a mistake when they teach this kind of models.
Of course, and then you stay with the older classical genetics because that's easiest to teach and then there's something to relate to. Yeah, so it's, so that's a problem if you're, and this is a very, I think, crucial thing to not stay in the old things but take in the new things. So, and that's not easy, I think it's very difficult because if the students don't have anything to relate to, it's very demanding to take in these biochemical ideas.
Yeah. Thanks. We solve all the problems of teacher education genetics in Brazil, me and Nicholas in the group.
Okay, I hope.
but speaking seriously.
I hope to cover it a little bit.
I think one of the main arguments we have been defending also is that how people teach about gene is a key problem in genetics education. And People are not paying enough attention to this problem. I think there are much more papers on problem solving genetics or how to differentiate gene from allele than about the gene concept. So I think it's a kind of, I don't know if I agree with this, but it is a kind of, people are not paying enough attention to this problem with gene, I think, in genetics education research.
Yeah, I think most people don't really understand the impact. As you said, it has, if you really, only as we have shown here, use this way of training, it has so big influence on the students. So it will have impact on most areas, although you are talking about the gene and allele and so on. So I think it's absolutely.
More questions?
Let's go. Thank you,
Lucas.
Thank you.